Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from Pastor Luke Cobray.
Father, we thank you for the opportunity that we have to be here. What a privilege, God, it is to come into the house of the Lord, that we get to come and to freely worship you, to let aside the cares that we have and that we hold on to, Lord, and lay those aside and focus and fix our eyes on your Son, Jesus, whom we acknowledge here at this church is our leader. Lord, this is your house. This isn't the church of a man or the words of a man, but Lord, we don't want to come to hear from a man. We want to come to hear from you. So Lord, we just ask today that your Holy Spirit would be our teacher, would counsel us and lead us and guide us and direct us in your word today, Lord, as we study it, that we walk out of this place, as your word says, that we would be equipped to be your church, to shine your glory, to do your works for this world, that they might know that you are a God in heaven who is in control and has blessed his children. And Father, we thank you for that and the opportunity that we have to be here. Thank you for the blessings that you've given to us in this house, Lord. We don't ask those blessings just upon ourselves. There are so many churches around the Inland Empire that are meeting tonight and all throughout the course of this week. And Lord, we know with the 2 million people that just call this place, the Inland Empire, their home, Lord, we know that we couldn't reach them all and do everything by ourselves. And Father, we thank you that you have called us into this place as co-laborers in the body of Christ with all of the various churches that proclaim Jesus as the Son of God. And Lord, we ask that you would bless them, Lord, as you have blessed us. Speak to them as you speak to us, Lord. And Holy Spirit, move upon them as we ask that you would move upon us. And Lord, we'll give you the praise and the glory and the honor. Open our eyes, open our ears, and open our hearts to see, to hear, to comprehend, and to remember your word, that we might walk out of this place better than when we came in. And Lord, we'll give you the praise and the glory and the honor. And we all said,
amen.
Amen. Well, tonight, if you're taking notes or to reference the message, I want to talk to you for a little while about the subject of who's got your back. Who's got your back? It is just good to know that somebody has your back. You know, we all need, I love how that song goes, right? We all need somebody to lean on. So just call on your brother when you need a friend. All right, anyways. Who's got your back? Don't get ahead of me now, all right? I'm preaching the message, not you. It's good to know that somebody's got our back. I remember a couple of years ago, we call them in the BC days, the before children days. You know, there's no way to hide it around it. My wife and I were very adventurous folk, and so my wife, she dragged me up to Northern California because she really wanted to go whitewater rafting. And I think it was a great idea. It was a lot of fun. It was a little intimidating. I mean, I've been in rivers with fishing and things like that. I mean, never underestimate the power of current. And so there we were whitewater rafting, and they give you a little briefing when you're rafting, before you go out on the raft. Okay, if you fall out of the raft, this is what we want you to do. We want you to point your feet downstream and do the best you can to keep your head above water and all these different things. And they tell you all these different things and safety precautions, and you got a little life jacket and things like that. But nothing quite prepares you for that moment when you're out there on the river and all of a sudden, the very first moment, you feel the frigid 48-degree snowmelt water. And it's all white and there's waves and everything's happening. And it was so nice to know that I was in a boat full of dudes, big, burly dudes, because man, if you're out in that water and you need somebody to pull you in, there is nothing better than a big, burly dude to pull you into that water. And it just so happens that we were out there rafting, and well, I'll just show you the little video. I was so blessed to have somebody film it for me. I'm the guy in the white sweater in the very front row. That's me. I fell in the water, if you're listening on the CD. There I am. I did exactly what they said. Aren't you proud of me? There I am. See, the big burly dudes to pull you in the water. Praise God for that. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, some of you are clapping because you know that was not a big burly dude. That was my wife. We were in a boat of 4 men plus the guide, 5 men and 2 girls. And here I am. I fell in the water. You know, it's so amazing. I'm so grateful for that video that it did not capture my eyes, because I looked like I did everything right. But in truth of the story is what happened in that brief seconds. You know when you're in water that's 48 degrees, like time is eternity. You know, every second is like a minute. So what happened is that little piece of water sucked me out from the boat. I literally didn't even know what happened. Didn't fall. All of a sudden, I just felt the pressure of the water pull me down. And when I came up, I actually came up for a minute second under the boat. So when I came up, I could feel the raft, and I panicked. I mean, I love that video because this is like total confessions because you would have never known or never guessed. I was panicking. There was a sheer look of terror in my eyes as I was swimming for dear life. Dear Lord, get me out of this water. And there was my little wife, 60-pound weight difference, who had my back. When nobody else jumped to help, my little wife grabbed my shirt and she put all, I mean, don't you love it? Put your back into it. She put all of her weight and she yanked me out of that water and pulled me onto the boat and then got my paddle into that boat. She was my hero for that day. Every time or any time her and I go whitewater rafting, I know somebody's got my back. It is good to know. When you go through life that somebody's got your back. It's just good to know. Whether you're married and you've got a spouse or friends or family, it's just good to know when you go through life that somebody's looking out for you. That somebody's there when you need help and somebody's there to call upon you. Because ultimately what happens to us, you and I, whether you're on a whitewater rafting trip or you're just in life, there's going to be a season when there's something that you cannot do on your own and you're going to need help. Whether you're like me, and I'll openly admit that I am the kind of person that will not admit. Does that work? Is that okay? I will admit that I don't admit that I need help. Or you're the other type of person on the other end of the spectrum where you say, I plainly and freely confess I could get all the help I could get. Amen. Some of you need help. Some of you more than others. Life comes at us. We all find seasons where we need help. And it's good to know that somebody has our back. Now, I might ask you the question, who has your back? And some of the more astute people in the audience might want to try to preach my message for me. But you might say, you know what? I'm so blessed that I'm in a relationship where I know that wherever I go, my wife supports me. Or my husband is there to hold my dreams. I've got kids that are building me up that I know that if I needed to help call on my kids to help something, that they would be there in a moment's notice. Maybe you say, I've got friends that I've known all my life. My parents told me when I was in high school that I would never talk to my high school friends, and I never believed that I would never talk to my high school friends, and I never talked to my high school friends. But maybe you have a childhood friend that you have been with through thick and thin, and you know that no matter what happens, they've got your back. But there are some of you in this place, if the question was to be asked to you, who has your back? And you were to look at your life, to look at the course of your life and through the hardships and the things that you've faced, that you've gone through, and you say, who was there when I was crying out? Who was there in my darkest moments of my life? Who was there? Everybody else was at the movies and smiling and doing their things. Who was there? You might say, nobody. Unfortunately, there's a lot of us in this place that would say and respond, I don't feel like anybody really has my back. Pastor Luke, I know where you're going to go with this, and I know where you're going to talk about tonight, and some of the more astute people in the congregation already blew my message, but that's okay. But the Bible gives us a really clear perspective about who's got your back. Because honestly, when we evaluate hard times, it's when we really are formed by those. When friendships that are superficial, we really begin to see who's really with us, who's really close to us, who we're really important to and who we're not, we begin to see those in these times of trial, in these times of need, and we're all going to face these times in our lives. And so the Bible gives us some clear perspective. So if you've got your Bibles, I just want to take you to two simple verses today in Psalms 121. Psalms 121, verses number 1 and verse number 2. But today we're just going to look at these, and I just want to talk a little bit about this subject of who's got your back. Psalms 121, verse number 1. It says, I will lift my eyes to the hills. Oh, I love that. I will lift my eyes. When I think of that verse, I think of Lord of the Rings. Any Lord of the Rings fans in here? Man, okay, there's a Lord of the Rings fan over there. I think of Gandalf, right? At the end of, the two towers at the end. He says, at the end of the third day on the first light, you'll see me look on the hill, right? I look to the hills. From whence comes my help? I love that word, from whence, right? From From whence? From where? Where does my help come from? You know, something about you and I, there's a question that we could always ask ourselves when you look at your life. Where does my help come from? Have you ever been backed into a corner in life? Maybe it wasn't emotionally or something like, maybe it was a project at work where you just realized that I feel like I've got nowhere to go and I feel like I've been backed into this corner. Maybe you were out, I remember there was a time in my life when I was out hiking, and I've told the story a few times where I got lost in the woods. I felt very backed into the corner, didn't know where to go, didn't know what to do. I felt like my options were running out. And here the psalmist says, I'll look to the hills. Is that where my help comes from? Because you see, what happens to us when we get that feeling of being backed into the corner as there's no more options, all of a sudden, the real us comes out. You know what I'm talking about? The real you, the facade, the smiles, the attitude, the whatever you might want people to think about you goes away, and the real you comes out. Because all of a sudden, those moments, those feelings, those emotions come up, those feelings of panic, those feelings of anxiety, those feelings of, I've got to fix this, and I've got to fix this right now, because if I don't fix this right now, I'm going to pay for this. I'm going to suffer for this. So here the psalmist is talking about the subject of help, this season in their life in which they need help, a season in which every one of us is going to face. So he says, I'll look to the hills. You see, something about you and I that we can learn about ourselves is whom or where we go first when we are looking for help determines a lot about our character. Put the statement up for me on the overhead, guys, in the back room. Who or where you run to first in time of need reveals a lot about us. Because the real you is exposed. Listen, the real you, we all have this person, man, I want to be a glasses half full kind of guy. You know what I'm talking about? Anybody know what I'm talking about? I look at optimistic people, and I think, man, that is me. Tomorrow, I'm going to be an optimistic guy. And then all of a sudden, life happens, and it's like, where did the optimism go? How did I just find the negative in the positive opportunity? That's just kind of the real me. You see, where we run to or who we run to first reveals a lot about you and I and about our character. The psalmist is talking about, I'm going to look to the hills. In the New Living Translation, he goes on and he says these words. He says, I'm going to look to the mountains. Does my help come from there? An interesting statement here, he says. I'm going to look to the mountains. Does my help come from there? You see, in the Bible, in the Old Testament particularly, the mountains represented one of two things. They represented a holy place, where a place where God would set somebody on high. Moses went on to the mountain where the Spirit of God was. The mountains always represented something holy to the people, but the mountains also represented high places to the people of Israel. See, through the course of the kingdoms of Israel, through the course of the various kings of Judah and of Israel, the Bible tells us that God had ought against them. Why? Because they did not remove, the Bible says, the high places. High places were places up on the mountain, up on the hills, placed in plain view in a vicinity of idols, of pillars of other gods, of statues, of shrines and memorial things, of people focusing and looking at their idols or their other gods. And so here, the psalmist says, I will look to the mountains because does my help come from the mountains, the high places? You see, what we run to first or who we go to first in our time of need reveals a lot about us. Have you ever had somebody call you, somebody that you haven't talked to in a long time, somebody that you lost communication with, and then all of a sudden, out of the blue, you get a phone call from them? You kind of wonder, what's going on? And they tell you these things, I didn't know who else to call. Maybe that's you. Maybe you were just going through a season, or you're in that season, where something happened to you in your life. You reached out to somebody, and you said, I don't know who else to go to. I didn't know who else to trust with this information. I didn't know who else would help me with this. You see, who we go to first says a lot about our character and about who we are, really who we are. So unfortunately, what happens is we look to the hills, to the high places of our lives, the things that we're comfortable with. Why? Because when hard times come our way, when we find that we need help, we run to what we're comfortable with. I'm comfortable with the old man, the man who lived the course of his life without God for so many years, and then all of a sudden God made a change. I'm comfortable with that man. I'm comfortable with that bottle that helps me to drown out my sorrow. I'm comfortable with that fix that helps me forget about my troubles. I'm comfortable going to that person over here, talking to that old friend over there, because they always seem to give me good advice when I need it. And unfortunately, so many of us do exactly what the psalmist is talking about here, is that we look to the hills. Is my help going to come to the hills? Is my help going to come from the high places? Is my help going to come from that bottle? Is my help going to come from that fix? Is my help going to come from that old friend? Is my help going to come from the old ways? Where we go to first reveals a lot about us on the inside. So he's talking about the mountains, and he's looking at that, and as I was reading through certain commentaries and certain historical things about the Word of God, and particularly Psalms 121, one commentator from the 1800s tells us about a story in Jeremiah chapter 3, verse number 23. He's talking about this, and he says, "It is in vain, truly in vain is salvation hoped for from the hills, the high places of your life, the old ways, the old person." Your help, while you might get good advice from that friend, from that loved one, from that person that's always been trusted, that's always led you the right way, he says, salvation is in vain from hope for from the hills and from the multitude of the mountains. Truly, in the Lord, our God is the salvation of Israel. So often we run to these high places of our lives, these places that we're familiar with, these places that we're comfortable with. In the seasons of great and the season of plenty, we say, God, you're so good and we thank you. And in the seasons of need and the seasons of trial, we go back to where we came from, the high places. We go back to the people that we came away from, the high places. We go back to the old ways that we came from, the high places. Because when everything else was going crazy in my life, I knew that if I did this or I knew that if I talked to that, that everything would settle down in my life. But you see, the salvation, hope, help, restoration doesn't come from the hills. It doesn't come from the high places of our lives. The people of old were so familiar of high places. Do you remember the story of Elijah and the prophets of Baal, where they were 400 prophets were looking at the high places under their idol God for salvation, for redemption, for the removal of this great drought? But yet Elijah says, your eyes are fixed on the wrong place. Because your help doesn't come from the hills. Your help comes from God. And I love what the psalmist says. Verse number 2. My help comes from the Lord. My help comes from the Lord. Your help doesn't come from the bottle. It doesn't come from the fix. It doesn't come from the old friends. It doesn't come from the social media. Man, do you love it when somebody, you can tell somebody is crying for attention? Because misery loves company. And they're begging and they're asking through bitterness and through harsh posts and through lashing out. They're suffering in their pain just so that somebody would recognize them. But you see, your help doesn't come from a positive comment on Facebook. Your help doesn't come from an old friend long ago. Your help doesn't come from the old ways. Your help, my help, comes from the Lord, from God, from Jesus Christ, who is the answer to my problems. My help comes from Jesus. I love this. There's a statement there he says at the end of that verse, who made heaven and earth. I mean, think about it for a moment. Just think about it for a moment, the psalmist. I mean, psalms are really great because they're poetic, and, you know, in poetry, you always want to emphasize and really paint this picture, but he really could have just stopped at, where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, period. End of argument, end of statement. But he adds a bit of perspective there. Who made heaven and earth? Think about that for a moment. My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. You see, there is nothing on God's created earth that will provide help to you like the creator of the earth. He knows all, beginning to end. He sees your life. He knows what's going on. He knows what's going to go on. He knows how it will end. So who better to go to than God? Has somebody ever come to you and asked you for advice? Man, I'm going through this right now, and this is just what's going on. Man, as a pastor, I get it all day long. Pastor, look, I'm going on, and I'm just like... They tell you a story, and some of you guys have stories that just, you couldn't even write it in fiction. And you just, I don't know what to tell you. I, as a person, I have no clue what to tell you. So maybe you've been that way. You felt inadequate. Somebody's asked you for advice or a direction or opinion. You say, I don't know where to take you with that. I don't know. You see, men can only take us so far. It's not wrong to seek advice and to seek help from somebody else. We need somebody physically in this world to lean on. But we need to understand that our help comes from God. As a minister, one of the things I love is to see what other ministers are doing. My wife will tell you, I am a bookworm. I got to read whatever the book is. I got to know. I want to know what John Bevere is doing. I want to know what's going on in Brian Houston's life. I want to know what's going on over here. I want to know what Craig Rochelle's doing over here. I want to know because they're going through things that I'm going through. And I find such encouragement when I read them. I was just reading a book yesterday. I read it to my wife. I was like, babe, remember that thought I was telling you in my life how I felt? And she's like, yeah. And I'm like, he felt it too. But you see, we can find encouragement from advice and from the direction of somebody else. But encouragement never substitutes God's help. You see, good advice will never outdo God advice. Good advice does not replace God advice. Because what we do, and I'm guilty of this, church, I'll just tell you, this is like Confessions of a Pastor night, okay? I told you about how afraid I was, whitewater rafting, Confessions of a Pastor. What we like to do is I like to read a book. Well, so-and-so had this revelation of something, such and such a topic. And because I read that book, that was my time seeking God. But you see, what somebody writes, what a man says, what a man directs, what a man preaches tonight, me to you, is not God advice. It's good. You need to go on your own in your own time and seek after God. You see, encouragement from men is great, but a book should never replace your seeking after God. It might enhance it, but don't read a book and call that your time with God. Why? Because they might give you encouragement. But encouragement only lasts for so long. The psalmist wanted to add to us so that we would get the glimpse of perspective here, that my help comes from the Lord, who is the maker of the universe, who sees all, who is in all, who is all. And that is where I need my refuge to come from, which means the responsibility on us is to seek after God. To go after him with our hearts. Because God's desire, church, listen, is that you don't feel alone. That you don't feel abandoned. That you don't feel like you're doing things all by yourself and that you have nobody to lean on. That's not God's will for your life. But unfortunately, too many Christians of the 21st century in the churches today that come into this place and other places, sit in these chairs, walk out of this building, and they say, I don't feel like I have anybody or anything in my life to support me. That was never God's desire for you. As a matter of fact, Jesus fulfilled the promise of God for you and I. John, the 14th chapter. John chapter 14, verse number 26. Jesus says these words, the helper. But the helper. See, my help doesn't come from the advice of men. My help doesn't come from the high places of my life that take me back or help me to remove the agony and the pain that I'm going through. My help comes from the Lord, the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name. He will teach you all things and bring to your, listen to this, and bring to your, oh my goodness, and bring to your remembrance the things that I have said to you. Have you ever felt down in the dumps? Anybody ever been there? You've been hard on me? I am hard on myself. I've been down in the dumps. My wife will tell you, I'm probably down in the dumps too much. And I'll get there and I'll say, babe, I don't know what I'm doing. I went up there and I preached a message and I don't know what I'm saying. Nobody listened to me. Nobody cared. I what am I doing with my life? And then I'll get harder on myself and say, man, I'm not even a good dad. I'm always doing this. I'm always doing that. And I'll just beat myself up and beat myself up and beat myself up. And I'm Mr. Eeyore walking in their house. Well, oh, well. And my helpmate, the Bible calls her, she'll come to me, not so gingerly. She kind of comes a little bit abruptly. She'll remind me, Bip, don't you remember when so-and-so came up to you after that message? They told you that it changed their life. Don't you remember when so-and-so emailed you that testimony about what you were talking about and they applied it and all of a sudden something was different in their life? Don't you realize that when you're gone, your kids talk all about daddy and that's all they talk about when you're gone? I'm kind of like, oh yeah, I forgot about that. Oh yeah. I remember that testimony, but I just wasn't thinking about it. I already knew him, but I wasn't thinking about him. We do that all the time. We do that all the time. I need help. God, I'm going through something and I need help. Oh, but I forgot to go to God. I went to my friends. I went to Oprah. I went to Dr. Phil, whoever else is on TV nowadays, Maury. I went to the bottle. I went to that fix again. I went to the computer late at night when nobody was watching. You see, that's not your help. Jesus says, I got something for you. I got something for you. You don't have to feel alone. You don't have to feel abandoned. Even though there might be another, might not be another physical person on this earth that you feel like has your back, it doesn't matter. Because Jesus says, I got something for you. The Helper, the Holy Spirit will come and he'll teach you and he'll remind you of all the things that I said. I said that you are a child of God. I said that you are called and chosen and blessed. I said you can do this. I said you don't have to be alone. I said I love you. And all of a sudden, like my helpmate, the Helper comes to us and reminds us, you're not alone. You're not doing this alone. May feel like everybody's abandoned you. May feel like everybody's left you. May feel like everybody's off doing their thing and everybody's smiling and everybody's having a good day, but you are having a storm of your life and it seems like nobody cares. The Holy Spirit's there, telling you, I care. I care. And I'm here. I'm here to listen to you. I'm here to hear your heart, the cries of your heart, and I'm here to give you hope, to give you healing, to give you the answers that you need to get out of the trouble you're in. I'm here. But I love how Jesus doesn't just leave us with the Helper. He says these words in verse number 27. He says, peace I leave with you. Not just peace. I love this. My peace. My peace. You don't want my peace. Why? Because my peace goes, comes and goes. You don't want Pastor Paul's peace. Man, I tell you, I've seen that. His peace is like, go. No, I'm just kidding, Pastor Paul. You don't want man's peace. Jesus says, I give you peace, my peace. I give to you. Not as the world gives, I give. You see, something about Jesus he carried that nobody had at that time. Jesus was an exemplary union of man and God in union. Constantly throughout Jesus' ministry, Jesus said these things to the Pharisees and to the religious. He said, the words that I speak are not mine. They're my Father's. You say, the deeds that I do, the works that I do, they're not mine, but they're my Father's. The places that he went, he knew where to go, when to go, at what time to speak, at what time not to speak. He knew exactly what to do at every given moment of his life, a life literally living without fear. Why? Because he was in union with God. The Bible tells us that the Holy Spirit descended upon him like the form of a dove. Jesus had the Holy Spirit. Jesus was in connection with God 24/7, in communion, every day, every moment, every aspect, every area of his life. Even when he was in the garden sweating tears of blood, the Holy Spirit was there saying, Jesus, I got you. And Jesus now says, this union, this connection, this covenant inside of me, I will leave it with you. And now all of a sudden, when Jesus died upon that cross and he rose again, and 120 were in the upper room 50 days later after Jesus' ascension to heaven, the Holy Spirit falls on him. And now all of a sudden, something forever changed. Because God's desire is that you don't feel alone, that you don't live abandoned and empty and hopeless and helpless. He says, I've given you the Holy Spirit. Which means, church, you right now, through Jesus Christ, have all the help in your life you need. Who's got your back? God's got your back. So when you're alone, abandoned, without hope, look to Jesus. Look to Jesus. Look to Jesus, because your help comes from him. But I love how God doesn't just help us. Isn't that cool? God, I need help. He doesn't just help me. You know what God does? God helps me. And by helping me, he helps others. He's not just going to work a little bit on me. He's going to give me everything I got and everything I need, and even more so that people will begin to see that God is working in me and I, through him, am helping others. Wait, what? Let me show you in the Bible. 2 Corinthians chapter 1. Paul the Apostle is talking about his afflictions. He's talking about his sufferings. Paul the Apostle says, he's in praise be to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is our merciful Father and source of all comfort. Remember that word helper that Jesus said? The helper will come. That same word helper also means comforter. The God of all comfort. Oh, I love this. I love this. It's so deep. It's so amazing. It goes so far, much farther than this. Look at verse number 4. When he comforts us in our troubles. Amen. Your help comes from the Lord, not from the high places, so that we can comfort others. When they are troubled, we will be able to give them the same comfort God has given us. When God is helping you, he's not just helping you. He's helping those around you you don't even know. Your help has such a magnitude in your life, you don't even realize sometimes what God is doing. My dad was a reject in the ministerial world 30 years ago. Pastor Jim would go to pastors' conferences and gatherings and breakfasts, and people would literally disassociate with him. He even went into one meeting one time, and a man that's local here looked at him and said, I thank God I'm not that man. About my dad. Why? Because he'd been divorced 3 times. Started a church that nobody went to. Who would want to follow this man? He needed comfort because nobody was with him. He was alone. It was just him and mom. And they talked about crying themselves to sleep and crying themselves to sleep. But God gave him comfort. And when nobody wanted him, God gave him comfort and said, I want you. I want you. I want you. But you see, it didn't just end with that. Because the comfort that he got from God, because nobody wanted him, now all of a sudden he and 12 other people that nobody wanted anything to do with got together, like they say, with the box of Kleenex, and they started a church with a commitment to church the people that nobody wanted. And you and I are here today because of that verse. Because God will help you in the areas that you need so that someday you will give that to somebody else and you will say, I am a walking testimony that my help does not come from the old. My help does not come from the man. My help does not come from the fixes. My help comes from God. And I'll fix my eyes on Jesus every moment of the day. Because like Romans says, if God be for us, who could be against us? Who could be against us? But this is the part of the message where you begin to say in your heart, Pastor Luke, I know that God is there to help me. Pastor Luke, I know that my help comes from the Lord, but I just feel like I need something else. I feel like I just need more. I know, Pastor Luke, I know that my help comes from God, but it's just not enough right now. It's not working. It's not getting me out of where I'm at. I'm in a pickle. I'm in a predicament. My marriage is falling apart. My life is literally in ruins right now. My family, you don't even know the story of my family. I mean, Pastor Luke, I need something. And I know that God's my helper, but I feel like I need more. You know, yesterday was so funny. I was with Adam here on our front row. We were at a gym. And I was listening to these college students. I wasn't eavesdropping. I made eye contact with him, and he kind of winked at me or kind of like nodded at me like, hey, I know you're listening to my conversation. I was listening to this college student talking to his buddy, and he was talking about buying a pair of shoes, gym shoes. So he had these new shoes on, and his buddy was like, where'd you get the money to buy those shoes? The guy was like, well, I had to use my credit card. And his friend was like, well, why'd you use your credit card? He's like, oh, man, dude, my bank account, oh, my gosh. He's like, my bank account had $7 in it right now. I have no money, so I had to use my credit card. And his friend proceeded to tell him, I was really proud of him, his friend proceeded to tell him, man, you need to be a better manager of your money. Like, you need to be a little bit smarter about your money. Like, if you don't have any money, you should have waited to buy the shoes. And the young college student proceeded to tell his friend, oh, no, I got a ton of money in my savings account. I just didn't want to use it. And so I just watched his friend, like, kind of shake his head, like, wait a minute. You went in debt and paid interest for those shoes when all along you actually had the money to buy the shoes to where you didn't have to pay back later and pay the interest payment on top of it. I could just see it rolling around in his friend's mind. You see, saying, I know that God is my helper, but I need more, is just like that young college student saying, I had the money, but I never used it. It's the wrong attitude. It's the wrong perspective. Useless thinking. You know what I'm talking about? Why? Because you're not using it. You know that God is your helper, but you feel like you need more? No. No. Jesus is the answer to everything in your life. There is nothing else that you and I need on this earth other than Jesus. Jesus even goes as far as to say, why do you worry about what you eat, what you drink, what clothes you're going to wear? Why do you worry about all these things? He says, does not God take care of the birds in the field and the flowers? And doesn't God value you more than the birds and the flowers? So if God would take care of the birds and the flowers, he goes on, he says, but if you seek him first and his righteousness, all of those things will be added unto you. You see, the perspective is out of alignment. You don't need anything but God. But we get used to the high places. But I need that fulfillment that I used to get from that person in my life because that's what I've lived with. No, that's a high place. But I need these people over here to acknowledge that I'm suffering, that they love me. No, that's a high place in your life. The only thing you and I need is Jesus. Amen. And Jesus will supply all of our needs according to his richness, his glory. I love what the psalmist says in Psalm 16. He says, I have set the Lord always before me. I have set the Lord always before me. He's saying, my perspective is in alignment. God is my first. Remember that statement? Who or where you run to first in time of need reveals a lot about you or me. I set the Lord always before me. When I'm in a hard time, before I call my friends, before I go see what the latest book is or 20 ways to fix my life tomorrow, before I do any of those things, I go to God. I chase him. I chase his kingdom. I chase his righteousness. I chase his words. I chase his passion. I chase everything about him because I have set him. And he says, because he is at my right hand, shall not be moved. God is there. The Holy Spirit is in you through Jesus Christ right now, which means because God is in you, if He is in you, what could be against you? You see, the scriptures are not just cliche. They're not just small. They're not just little to you and I. Oh, Pastor Luke, I heard that in church a million times. No, literally speaking, if God is for you, who on earth or in hell or anywhere else could be against you? But we got to stop looking at the hills. Stop looking to the old ways and the high places, to the things of this world. Church, let's stop looking for our help to be coming from the next politician, our help to be coming from the next promise, our help to be coming from the next boyfriend girls or the next girlfriend boys, our help to be coming from that next person in our lives. Your help does not come from the hills. Your help comes from the Lord, who created the earth and the heavens. Who's got your back? God's got your back. God before us, who could be against us? So as we walk out of this place, put your head up. Remind yourself of what Jesus says about you. You can. You're a child of the living God. God loves you. He values you. He cares about you. That He sees a future and a promise and a hope in your life. Because these are the things that God says about you. God's got your back. God has got your back. So when life comes at you and me, and when I want to get down in the dumps, and my helpmate wants to come and remind me so gingerly like she does so lovingly, and when she says, get over yourself. Remember, the Holy Spirit's there, the helper, the comforter, to teach you. Lord, I don't know what to do right now. God, I feel like I'm backed into a corner. Teach you. God, I don't know where I'm going right now. To remind you. God, what's going on in my life? To direct you. God has got your back. Stop looking at the hills. Start looking at Jesus, because that is where your help comes from. You guys get something out of that? Give the Lord a great big praise in the house today. Amen. God is good. Before we go any further, I'm going to do things a little out of order. So I'm going to ask you, just give me a moment. I know everybody's like, oh, this is my time to leave. Nope, I'll give you that moment in just a minute. Give me a couple more minutes of your attention. Because there are those of you in this place, every service in this place, there are those of you that come into this place, and you think, perhaps you know, or perhaps you're under the assumption that everything's good in your life with you and God, but your life's a mess. I don't know everybody in this place. It's not the time to get up and leave. And it would be a shame and a tragedy for me to leave right now under the assumption that we're all good. Oh, well, go and find God. I want you to look at your heart, to look at your life like we spoke about today. Who's got your back? Maybe you're that person right now. You're looking at your heart, you're looking at yourself, and you're saying, you know what? To be honest with you, I don't feel like anybody has my back. And I saw people next to me clapping, and I saw somebody stand up and waving. I see the excitement of them, but I just don't have that. I don't experience that. You see, we come today with so many pretenses and so many assumptions as to why everything's good with us and God. We have been fed so many different stories and fairy tales and good messages or good intentions. But Jesus says that the road is narrow to the kingdom of God. So many times we come into this place and we look at our lives and we say, well, if I think that I'm okay with God, everything's going to be all right. We look at our lives and we say, you know what? I grew up in church. I was watching a TV show, and it was crazy. I mean, these people were talking about being baptized, and their friend was getting baptized, and they were like, man, I can't believe that she took this long to get baptized. And they're talking about how everything's going to be great because she's baptized, and now she's going to heaven, and they got baptized as a baby. So they were already good with God. So we think, well, somebody sprinkled water over me. They prayed over me when I was a child. I went to Sunday school classes, or I went to church. You know what? My parents all my life told me that I was a Christian. Some of you are in that boat. The census came knocking on your door in 2010, and you checked off Christian. But just because you claim Christian, just because somebody sprinkled water on you, just because you think, you hope that you're right with God, doesn't make everything right. Because you see, there's a lot of ways the Bible or the world wants to tell us that we can find God. I was talking to a young girl, or actually it was my friend, Pastor Joe, was talking to a young girl. I was so proud of him as he was talking to her. And he asked her about Jesus, and he asked her, and she says, you know, I think that my life is just kind of like, be good, do good, and it'll be all good. And she just said these words, but that's my belief. Kind of like, back off. You believe what you want to believe. I'll believe what I want to believe. We'll all get there the same way. I wish it was that easy. I wish it was that simple for us to think positive thoughts, to come and feel goosebumps on our arms during a service, and to go every once in a while and wear a cross around our neck or whatever it might be, or give ourselves a title. I wish it was that easy, because, man, the road would be wide if it's that easy. But Jesus says the road is narrow and the gate is small. Why? Because we can't get to heaven. We can't get in connection and union with God our way. Well, I'll find God my way, you find God your way, I appreciate your effort. No, I'm sorry, it doesn't work that way. The Bible is very clear that the only way we can get to God, God's heaven, God's connection, God's relationship, and God's help in our lives is through his son, Jesus. The Bible says that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And he says no one goes to the Father except through him. See, the harsh reality of our life is that the Bible says that we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. I've got a 4-year-old and a 2-year-old, and they are liars. Did you eat that cookie? Nope. You know what's funny, though? I never taught them how to lie. I never taught them how to hide and steal. I never taught them how to kick at each other and bite each other and pester each other. I never had to teach them that. That's the sin nature in you and I. Nobody had to teach you how to sin. It was easy. But you see, the only way we can get to God is God's way, Jesus. We've all fallen short. No matter how hard we try, I can't buy it. I can't earn it. I don't deserve it. I can't work for it. The only thing I can do is accept the gift, the Bible says, of salvation. The gift of God is eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. It's a gift. Jesus says these words to a religious leader, a man who memorized scripture, did all the right things, and looked the right part. He would have been the religious man of our day. Jesus says that in order to see the kingdom of God, you must be born again. Born again, it's not what Hollywood's made it out to be. They even had a sitcom about it. It's not what you read about on the internet, that weirdo, crazy, out of control Christianity. You see, born again from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible has always meant the same thing to God. Here it is. It means that you've given him all of your heart. You've given him all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with God the Father through his son, Jesus Christ. As a matter of fact, in the Bible, in the book of Revelation, I'll prove it to you. Jesus says these words. He's talking to the church believers, to you and me. And he says, listen, I'm coming back, and I'd rather find that you're hot, or I'd rather find that you're cold. He says, because if I find that you're lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. That's a shocking statement. You see, the church in which Jesus was talking to had natural geothermal hot springs. If you read about it geographically, they had hot water flowing and they had cold water flowing. And hot water was medicinal and cold water was refreshing, but lukewarm water did nothing. It sat there and it got stagnant. And Jesus says, I'd rather find that you're all the way. Because he says, if I find that you're in the middle, stagnant, doing nothing, I'm going to reject you out of the kingdom of God. And I love you enough, and I respect you enough, and I honor you enough today to not come in and teach you a message that God's got your back and leave and let you leave today under the assumption that everything's all right when you need to make a decision in your life tonight to accept the gift of God through eternal salvation, and that's Jesus. How do you do that? Jesus says that if you confess him before men, he will confess you before his Father. He says that if you deny him, he will deny you. Listen, it's not about an abracadabra magical prayer formula. God said, oh, they said the magic words. Nope, doesn't work that way either. It's It's an all-or-nothing relationship with God. And it starts by surrendering your life, by confessing that Jesus is the Lord and Savior. What does that mean, Lord and Savior? We don't talk like that. How about this, the leader of your life? Say, God, I don't want to be in control anymore. I realize that I will not be moved because you are always by my side, driving my life. Today, I want to give you that opportunity. In a moment, I'm going to ask you to do something real bold, real courageous, because I believe you can. I'm going to ask you to do something. I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. I'm going to count to three. I'll go one, two. And on the count of three, I'll go three. I'll smack my hands together real loud. And when I smack my hands together, I'm going to ask you to just do something. Pop your hand up. You see, what you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're making that decision. You got to make a decision. I'm going to follow Jesus. I want to give my heart. I want to give my life to Jesus Christ. Pastor Luke, like you were talking about today, I've been alone all my life. There's an emptiness on the inside of me that no matter what I try to do, I can't seem to fill. You know, Jesus says that the thief comes but not to steal, kill, and destroy. Do not be naive in thinking that heaven and hell are not a real place. There is a devil in hell who hates your guts. But Jesus said these words, I have come that you would have life and have it more abundantly. God's desire for you is life. Not just eternal life in heaven, life here on earth, life in your family, life at your workplace, life with your friends, life with your children, life in everything you do through Jesus. But it starts by making a decision to accept him in your life. So today I'm going to count to three, and when I do, I'm going to ask you to do that. Who should raise your hands? You've never given Jesus your heart, never given him your life. If that's you in just a moment, you pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. Who should raise your hands? Maybe I'm not sure. Pastor, look, I did this one time. I remember in a youth group, or I went to Greg Glory's Harvest Crusade. It was really cool. I went down there and I prayed a prayer, but I just never really followed through with it. I still feel empty. I still feel void. I still feel vain in my life. Listen, if that's you, don't walk out of this place without making sure today, because God's got your back and he wants you to start living life today. Maybe you've been living lukewarm. You know it. You've been coming to church and you're doing the thing like we talked about, the real person. You put on that facade, oh, everything's good with me and God. But then when life really happens, when you're in the darkness of your own home at night, when nobody else is looking, the real you cries out. If that's you in this place, let's stop living life for us. Stop living life down and broke out, because God wants you to live life today. But it starts by accepting Jesus, because God's got your back. Chase him. Chase him today and make that decision. You say, oh, if I raise my hand, I think I'm going to be embarrassed. I will not embarrass you. But even if you felt embarrassed, wouldn't it be better to spend a moment, think about it, a moment of embarrassment than spend an eternity in hell because you couldn't make that decision, that smart, that wise, that foregoing decision? It starts today. Spirit of God speaking to you in this place, and I'm going to stop talking now. I'm going to start counting. Wherever you're at, from the front to the back, you guys in the family rooms, I can see you through the windows. Even if you're at home right now watching on the live stream, or you're out in the foyer watching on the televisions, wherever you're at, the Spirit of God speaking to you, this is your moment, this is your time right here, right now, to accept life and to know that you are not alone and that God has desired all of your life that you would live life courageous and victorious. And it starts with Jesus. So when I count to three, if that's you, I want you to be bold. I want you to be proud of this. You're making the best decision you possibly can. You ready? All across this auditorium, front to back, wherever you're at, this is your moment. This is your time. Here we go. You ready? I'm going to count to three. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. One, two, three, four, five, six. I got you. Seven, I see you right there. Eight, I see you right there. Eight wise people, I got you right there in the red. I got you right over there. Eight wise people, I got you. Oh, nine, I got you back there. 10, I see you way over there in the back. 11 back there in the back. Right on. Anybody else in this place, you say, man, I wonder if I should. I see you right there, my man. I got you. 11 or 12 wise people. Anybody else in this place? 13, I see you guys. All right. 13 wise people. You say, man, I wonder if I should. Yes. Yes, you should. Jesus says that nobody comes to the Father unless he's drawn. Come on, that's the Spirit of God speaking to you right now, saying, come on, child. Choose life. I didn't embarrass them. I won't embarrass you. You know it's you today. If that's you, number 14, number 15, come on. This is your moment. God's rooting you on in heaven. I got you. Look at you. Good job. Number 14, anybody else? It's time for you. Stop doing it your way. Start doing it God's way. Where you at, number 15? Anybody else in this place? Where you at, number 15? I can sense you in here. All right, number 16. Forget number 15. Where are you at, number 16? Anybody else in this place? Well, hey, let's praise God for 14 wise people. Yes! Amen. Hey, here's what we're going to do. All 14 of you that raise your hands, Maybe you're number 15, and maybe you're not number 16. Say, man, I wonder if I should, or I missed it. No, you didn't miss out. You're making a decision. Remember I said that you're making a decision to follow Jesus. You know this. I know this. This is logic 101. Every decision requires action. You don't get saved because you raise your hand in a church service. You get saved because you give your heart, you give your life over to Jesus Christ. And we're going to do that together. We want to help you. We want to pray with you. We want to equip you. We want to get some information into your hands. I don't want you leaving this place empty-handed. I want you leaving this place courageous as a lion to get at life what God has for you. But it starts by you following through and acting on that decision. So in a moment, we're all going to stand. Elijah's going to sing a song. All of you that raise your hands, number 14, 15, 16, if you didn't raise your hand, I want you to get out of your seat, get out of your chair, and I want you to come meet me right here at this altar. We're going to change destinies together right here, right now. So if you raise your hand, or you should have raised your hand, come on, wherever you're at in this place, come and meet me right here, right now. Let's change destinies together. Come on. If that's you, you come. This is your moment right now. You can come. This is your moment.
Jesus, you set me free. Thank you, Jesus, for love.
That's you. Come on, it's not too late. Time for you to get out of your chair and come. Come. Praise God. You guys came. You got to know something. Heaven is going bonkers right now. You think the Seahawks fans are loud? 12th man? No. The Bible tells us that the pillars, the foundations of heaven, are shaking over angels, rejoicing over you right now. I mean, how cool is that? Heaven's having a party in your name. You're not going to a funeral. You're going to a birthday celebration. You're going to get born again. Today's the first day of the rest of your life. Everything's changing from this moment forward. Here's what I want to do. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here waving at you? He's a really cool guy. I really like this guy. As a matter of fact, I really want to be like him. Okay? He's really cool. He's going to take you guys just right over there. Nothing weird goes on. I'm as weird as it gets, I promise. All right? He's going to take you guys just right over there. He's going to lead you in a prayer. You get saved by asking Jesus, inviting him into your heart to be the Lord and Savior, the leader of your life like we talked about. Secondly, he's going to give you some free information. We don't want you to leave empty-handed. We want to leave pointing you and setting you off in the right direction on this journey that you're going to run. We're going to set you off on the right foot. The third thing he's going to do is he's going to give you a friend. We give away friends here at the church. Somebody that will meet with you right here at church for a couple of weeks to teach you some things about the Word of God. So that, you know, like you go to the gym, you get that personal trainer. Why? Because you don't want to look like a fool and not use all that equipment. They don't have, everybody's looking at you all week. No, we're going to give you a spiritual personal trainer. Somebody that will teach you the things of God. It's not some big long program or anything like that. It's a friend that will sit with you for a couple of minutes, for a couple of weeks, and teach you some things about the Word of God to get you strong in the ways of God. So that you don't go back to the life that you're leaving, walking away from right now, those high places that we were talking about. But you look to God and you focus on Jesus and you run your race and you go with everything God has for you. So if you guys just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with my buddy, Pastor Joel. Congratulations. Amen.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow, you repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me. And then he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven, as well as upon the earth, that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.